Okay, so the question is what is advanced. I don't know what topics I should do exactly. So I put together some topics which are interesting from my point of view, and I would all invite you that you post some wishes, what you want to hear about for tomorrow in the discussion forum. So for now, I have put together the following plans. The following plan: I want to talk a little bit about dependency in JSX, between JSX graph elements, then about math checks and HTML. Bidirectional communication with HTML elements, constructing with loops, then this Jesse code and how to dump a construction. You will find this PDF about containing the code of which we will use in this workshop. It's on the conference course. So. Okay, just a reminder, what do we have to do to see JSX graph or to use JSX graph in an HTML page? Well, we have to include the library file, this JSX graph core file in the HTML. And the best thing is to use it from one of the CDNs, for example, from jsdeliver.net. And if you want to use LaTeX symbols, then we also have to include math checks. And as Igor said before, we have to use one division which we name with an ID. And then later on, we will fill this division with JSX graph board by calling init board and giving this ID as parameter. Okay, then I want to recall a little bit of JavaScript at the beginning. Just to be sure that we all speak about the same. The way in JavaScript to define a function is, having a variable name for this function, like f, and set it to function, and this function block, and then call return somewhere in this function. In newer versions of JavaScript, ES6 at least, we have the so-called arrow functions, which are more lightweight. And this does exactly the same. It maps x to x squared via this operator equal and greater than. And one more concept, which is quite helpful, we don't have to give names to functions. We can use them without names, like we use sometimes a parameter. We give sometimes a parameter named 3 or 4 to a function. We can give a function without name as parameter to a function. Like this, here this function, my function, receives the parameter function, it's an anonymous function which does squaring. And the same is possible with arrow functions. Okay, Igor didn't say yet anything about function graphs. I want to start slowly, and I'm using I'm using the JS Fiddle, which is a good place to do prototyping with JSXGraph. So if you go to the homepage of the JS Fiddle link, and then or in this template which is opened, JSXGraph is already included. So and the board is constructed. Well, one way to plot a function is to call board create function graph, and then supply the JavaScript function of the function term which we want to plot. So usually we have one parameter x, and well, let's say return x times x.
Alfred, create, not cretai.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Okay. This is one possibility. Of course, we can do the same with arrow functions if we have a new browser. So this is the way to plot the sine function. Here we have JavaScript supplies the sine function in the math object. Okay. And then the third possibility, namely to use Jesse code. And the advantage of Jesse code is that you don't have to use the math object of JavaScript, and you can directly type sine like students are used to in schools. The disadvantage or the difference is that you give a string as parameter. Okay. This is about plotting. Okay, this was the entry. Now we want to go to a typical problem in JSXGraph. Namely, we have a point. We call this point 3. Okay, here it is. We can drag it around. And now we want to have a second point which is somehow dependent on this, which is somehow depends on the position of this point A. And this can be realized with functions. So here we create a second point, and for the x coordinate, we supply a function which returns the x coordinate of the free point. And the y coordinate of this new point is fixed to 1. Okay, then I cannot drag this point B, but I can drag A. And the point B will follow A. And have always the same x coordinate. This is the most important principle in advanced JSXGraph. Use functions as parameters. We can do the same with arrow functions. We create another point, dep2, and Well, the first, the x-coordinate will also have the x-coordinate of this first point, of A, and the y-coordinate of this point will be the y-coordinate of the free point plus 2. Okay, and then it will follow the point A. Okay, yeah, this is the first step to implement dependencies between elements. We also have the possibility to do this with sliders. Here's an example from the wiki. Here we have three sliders. And you can access the slider value by calling the method value. And well, and this function graph is defined by A times the value of the slider A times x squared and so on. So we can manipulate the function graph by manipulating the sliders. A typical example for schools. Okay. This is very nice. And the good thing is, we hope it's a good thing, is that we can use this dependency functions to manipulate also attributes. So we can do the following. We create a slider. Get the slider. And we create a polygon, a regular polygon or quadrangle. So this quadrangle starts with two points. This is standard. Okay, let's first show it. Missing a semicolon, what's missing?
Alfred, I think that you didn't copy everything.
Oh, yeah. Okay, let's start from, the copying in the Mac doesn't work too good, okay. So here's the quadrangle and the slider, they are not connected yet. So I can, the first step, what I want to do is setting, making the fill opacity dynamic. So fill opacity is takes a value between 0 and 1, and but I don't supply this value. I supply a function which returns a value between 0 and 1. So this slider returns values between 0 and 1. Okay, and now if you drag this slider, you get you get a dynamic opacity. So this is one thing we can do. The next thing is we can have some kind of trigger, namely in case the slider value is equal to zero, we want to hide the quadrangle completely. So we do this and we turn off, we set the slider to zero, then also the edges of the polygon disappear. And we can do this for the labels, for the vertices too. This is and here I have to so yeah. So then everything disappears. Okay, this is an example how to hide, how to manipulate attributes by dragging things around. And this works for nearly all attributes. Okay, the next part I want to show is setting attributes. There's a little bit confusion sometimes how to set an attribute. So we start again. In the PDF, you always see the links to this JSFiddle. So I don't save it now. So first we have, let's look at a simple point. Okay, we saw points already, nothing exciting. So if we want to, it may be that we have many boards in a page and we want to change the layout of the points for all these boards, then we use this syntax. So before constructing the first board or point, we change for constructing the point as the board, we set JXG options and then some attributes like this. Okay, it's a little bit bigger and blue. And now from now on, all points will have this color and this size. Okay, then the next step, what we can do is we can change the attributes of a board. So if you're working in this board now, which is defined in line number 4, then from now on, all points will receive point size 10. So this is a global attribute to this board now, from now on. So it will be a little bit larger. And of course, we can change the attribute for one point locally. We can make it bigger, and we can change the attribute of this point at a later stage by calling set attribute. Now it's yellow. Okay, so there are three ways to set the options. So it's JXG options, and it's board options, and it's it's using the attribute object. And so if you use this JXG options, which you also can load in a separate file, you can create your own template for your constructions. Yeah, next step. For the next step, include math checks. For this, I open an existing JS Fiddle. Yeah, and you see in the resources, we load JS Extract Core, JS Extract CSS, and the math checks code. And important for using math checks in text elements is to set the options text use math checks equals true. Okay, then the first step is completely standard by now. We create a slider and we create a function graph depending on this slider. Maybe we comment this out for the moment. And then it's just the exponential function. The exponential function depending on the slider value. Okay. Now we want to visualize this with with LaTeX text, and we create a new text element, position it at -47, and for the content will be a function returning some text. And this text is for LaTeX people, it's e to the power of k times x. And what we have to, the most important thing is we cannot use a single backslash, because by some text mangling of the JavaScript interpreter, this will get lost. So you have to mask backslashes by another backslash. So you have to double the backslashes. And then, so we have this constant text, then we add a dynamic value, and then another constant text. And if we have a look at it, then you see the result. And in order to only get integer exponents or integer multiples of the exponent, we set the attribute snapWidth to 1 for the slider. We also can set it to 0.5. Okay, you see the principle behind it. Okay, this is math checks, and we recommend to use math checks with version 3. It's extremely fast, and it gives pretty beautiful results. So if we are about to create math checks, then the next step is to include HTML. One example is the following. It's also from the wiki. We have some HTML input field, input element, and some HTML buttons, and we use it to plot. So you don't, this is interesting for learning management systems where you have one element, one div, which contains everything. And the way to do it is to use the button element of Chase Extra, which is just an HTML button element, and the input element, which is an input form tag of Chase Xgraph. But you can do more. And you can do more. Yes, and this is exactly the question. Can I supply a drop-down selection? the thing is, the solution is you can supply anything. What you want. You can supply any HTML in the text of a JSXGraph text element. You can supply anything. The point is, can I do this with labels? Let's try it out. Board create point 1, 1. Let's do it first. Okay. And name. H1 hello. Yeah, it works. Okay. It will not work for tick elements because usually most text elements the default text element is an HTML div shown above the construction. The exceptions are tick labels. They use SVG text elements. So you have to display to be sure that you will use HTML. You have to add the attribute display HTML. Okay. So how does access the selection in the embedded HTML element? Yeah, you can. I will demonstrate it here. You just give the ID of your the ID of your choice to this element, and then you can access it from outside. Okay. Well, maybe the last thing for today, bidirectional communication with DOM. So sometimes it's useful if you want to show some value, display some value in a form element, some value of a JSXGraph element in a form element of the page, but simultaneously you want to allow to change this JSXGraph element by changing this value. Well, make it, we just show it to you from the wiki. So you see this construction, and when I drag the point, the glider around the circle, the degree, that the angle in degrees will be shown in this input field. Okay. But now I also want to allow the user to change this value. And I have to click on set direction, and then it moves to this value. How do I do this? Well, the first thing is to use JSX Graph events, event handlers, event listeners. We supply this point or this glider P. He listens to the event drag. If someone drags it, then the HTML value is set. And on the other hand, if one clicks on the button, then there's a tiny little animation started. We call move to, and go to this and move this point to this to this position in the and do this in 1,000 milliseconds, so in 1 second again. Okay. Yeah. Okay. This is there some sort of event handling? Yes. Okay. This is exactly what I what is available. So there's the drag, the move, and many other events available. Okay. This is the first part of the advanced JSX Graph workshop. Well, I still have plans for tomorrow. You see it in the PDF, but I'm open to any kind of wish you can write down in the forum. Thank you very much.